That's fine.
This is the seat of the High Kings of Ireland. This was the seat of government before it was moved to Dublin. So the ancient history of Ireland is centred around this hill, the Hill of Tara, which is a corruption of the Hill of Torah. And Torah is God's law that Jeremiah and Queen Teia Tephi brought from Jerusalem in the Ark of the Covenant here to Ireland and instituted in Ireland. And it brought peace and prosperity to the whole of Ireland for the first time. So what we're looking at now was the original ancient entrance or chariot run approach to the Hill of Tara, from where the High Kings of Tara ruled Ireland. And if they didn't come in this way, the official entrance, then they knew that they were up to no good. You can get the idea also from these tracks that are down the middle of it.
Yeah.
The high seat of the kings.
Right, so I'll just pan round to 180 degrees.
And that's the mound of the hostages you can
in the centre?
Yes.
So what's the name of this mound that we're heading towards more deep?
Rath Gronya.
And this is a mound within an outer defensive ring, yeah?
Yeah.
So, who lived here, Mardib?
Teia Tephi, the Queen of Israel, who was brought from Jerusalem. They built her a house here.
So there was a house in the centre of this mound, here, okay. Has it ever been excavated and dug up to see if there's any remnants of it? Or?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
Okay.
And they placed over the doorway, in Hebrew, the word Jerusalem, so that she would feel more at home.
Mm-hmm.
And she is away from where the menfolk would be. She would be here with her two handmaidens, protected, but away from the menfolk, because the men would be up on the hill.
Mm-hmm.
At the Wrath of the Synods and on the actual hill itself.
Right, we're standing on the Wrath of the Synods, which is another mound, and just in the mid-ground there, that's the Mound of the Hostages, and behind it is the Inauguration Mound, where the kings and queens of Ireland were inaugurated. Is that right, Mardib?
Yeah.
So there's quite a lot of people milling about on top of the Inauguration Mound, and You believe this is the important mound, Mardib, the Mound of the Hostages, which has got this fence around it.
Yeah.
Where your claim of the covenant, all of the covenant is, actually underneath that mound.
Yeah. The Torah was taught here. They actually built a university here, as we would call it today.
Mm-hmm.
And all the firstborn of the families in Ireland would send all the families in Ireland that could afford it would send their firstborn sons here mm-hmm. to learn the law, the Torah, as it says in the Torah that must be done. This Wrath of the Synods, the word synod, like from the Church of England, it means an assembly.
Mm-hmm.
So this was the fort of the assemblies where all the regional kings of Ireland would meet three times a year, as it specifies in the Torah, in the law. They would meet here three times a year, and then they would discuss what was happening in Ireland, if any of them needed help, or how to sort out disputes and all mm-hmm. of that. They would all assemble and they would sort out any problems.
So the Mound of the Hostages, that suggests to me there were some hostages who were killed and buried there, is that right? Or?
That's one of the stories from a later period, from mm-hmm. the time of Niall.
Mm-hmm.
But in actual fact, if you look in the Bible, it refers, in Chronicles in the Bible, it refers to the Ark of the Covenant and the treasures from the temple as being the hostages.
Right.
And those are that's the real way that it got its name.
Okay. And just to play devil's advocate more, Dave, you saying that the Ark is the hostages, Is that your own contention, or are there any other scholars who would?
There are other people, yes, that over many years have said the same thing, that the Ark of the Covenant is buried here. And I'm going to explain that this goes back at least to the 1800s.
Okay.
In 1898, some people calling themselves the British Israelites, who'd researched some of the ancient writings, and they'd found one clue to the location of the Ark of the Covenant. And that clue said that it was buried in the south of the Wrath of the Synods.
Mm-hmm.
So they came here in 1898, and they were digging, looking for the Ark of the Covenant.
Mm-hmm.
And of course they didn't find it, because it wasn't in the south of the Wrath of the Synods. In the parlance of that time, in the south of meant to the south, mm-hmm, of the Wrath of the Synods. And from here to the south coast of Ireland is, technically speaking, in the south of the Wrath of the Synods.
Mm-hmm.
So that one clue doesn't tell you anything, really. And so when I arrived here in 1998, I was told that the story that the, it's not there because the British Israelites dug here in 1898 and they found nothing. And so they said that I was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And have tried to ridicule me. But unlike the British Israelites in 1898, I searched all the ancient writings and I have the three coordinates to actually pinpoint the location.
Mm-hmm.
And I have been trying to persuade the Irish Ministry for Heritage to allow me to recover the Ark, because this is a protected heritage site, and you can't turn a blade of grass without a license or a permit from, mm-hmm, the government.
Big fence around it for some reason.
Yeah.
Very interesting idea, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
Is that, why do they not want people in there then?
Well, they say that they are doing repair work, but it looks more like a building site.
I'm standing directly to the north of the Mound of the Hostages. And you were saying that someone a few years back was actually had a dig here?
Yes. It was Irish archaeologist called Helen Roach.
Mm-hmm.
In 1998, when I arrived, this area, she was digging here. This area was all exposed, all just earth. And there were iron and bronze remnants from,
right,
a foundry here. And she worked her way towards the Mound of the Hostages,
mm-hmm,
getting closer and closer to the Mound of the Hostages, and still finding iron,
mm-hmm,
and bronze remnants. And then they stopped her from digging.
A ridge where?
There's a ridge here where my foot is.
Okay.
Just there.
Ridge there.
And she dug all this area here, under that bank, and here.
Uh-huh.
And kept digging closer and closer to the Mound of the Hostages.
Uh-huh.
And it's very difficult, you can't really see the lines now, but she got closer and closer to the Mound of the Hostages and still finding remnants from the iron foundry.
Mm-hmm.
And had to stop, because if she kept going and was finding these iron deposits,
yeah,
up to and under the mound, it would have proved conclusively that the Mound of the Hostages is not Stone Age,
mm-hmm,
that it's actually Iron Age.
I'm very interested to see if there's a notice explaining why there's a fence on this.
Okay.
So let's see if we can find one. So it's saying conservation works at the Mound of the Hostages. So where they've actually removed earth at this entrance, and the turf, they've just piled it up over here behind the mound, and just there's weeds growing on it. Alright, so we're just at the fence here, and there's some boards here showing us what it actually looks like behind the plastic, which is a little entrance, a little stone entrance with a gate. A shame to come all this way to see they've got plastic over it.
Turn it into a building site.
It's a shame.
They've been doing something.
Yeah. And I've had Irish people who have followed my story for a number of years, and believe me,
mm-hmm,
who think that they're using this as a pretext to investigate my claims.
Right.
And without publicising that fact. Okay. Otherwise, why would they be digging holes?
Oh, yeah. And there's another one over here. Stand up one there. And there's another one where, did you say?
Another one over here to the right, but you can't see it.
I can't see that one, but there's, I can see that one there. So it doesn't. I can't really tell whether the it goes down any way, but.
If you were going to repair it, presumably you would just add solidify it.
Do you think they might have actually found something, Mardib, and took it away?
No.
You don't think so?
No. They couldn't, not from where they are.
Right, okay. So do you think they found out any information regarding what might be there?
I have no way of knowing.
Right.
It's not something they would publicise. It's certainly not something they would tell me.
Right. All right, well, let's go and have a look at the inauguration mound then. Stone of Destiny.
Yeah, was brought from Jerusalem. It was placed here. And Queen Teia Tephi and the High King of Ireland were married on this inauguration mound in 583 BC. And they gave their vows standing over the Stone of Destiny. And then all the High Kings of Ireland for 1,000 years were crowned here on this mound on the Stone of Destiny. It's still considered to be the capital, the spiritual capital of Ireland. Even though Ireland is divided into the north and south, and the north is predominantly Protestant, the south is predominantly Catholic, still both of the religions, both of the people from the north and the south consider this to be the spiritual capital of Ireland. And I'm facing due north.
The ark was buried, and then the tomb was sealed until her death, and then it was opened. She was placed in with the ark, and then it was resealed, and nobody's been in there since. And we're talking about, you know, thousands, 2,500 years. But in one of the ancient Irish documents, it says that she was buried northeast of the Forad. And the Forad is the Gaelic word for the inauguration mound. Okay, so the Wrath of the Sinners is here. The inauguration mound and Forad is here, okay? And it says that she was buried northeast. South of the Wrath of the Sinners is the Mound of Hostages, okay? Which is also northeast from the inauguration mound, okay? And then in another one of the ancient Irish documents, it says that after her husband had buried her, he raised a mound over her, which is 60 feet by 60 feet, which is their way of saying it was a circle, and it was 60 feet in diameter, because it was the same cross. And the Mound of the Hostages on the hill of Tara is south of the Wrath of the Synods. It is northeast of the Inauguration Mound, and it is, or was at the time it was built, approximately 60 feet in diameter. So that tells us that is the actual location. What happened was that they dug out, and then they built a stone chamber completely under the ground. And then all the earth that they'd excavated to make that underground chamber, they then used to make the mound over the top of it.
So just to finish, what do you think the chances of actually them excavating under the mound is? I mean, they've obviously been messing about with it in some capacity.
Yeah.
Why? It's anyone's guess, but what do you think the chances of you actually seeing that being dug up is? Do you see that happening?
Not where they're digging, no, because they're digging in the wrong place.
Right, okay.
And only I know where the right place is.
Okay, I mean, you've said that it's under the mound.
Yeah.
But do you think it's a even more specific than that? I know you're not going to say that. But.
Yeah, I know exactly where to go. Right. You see, they can do what they've done, which you filmed today, and what they did in 1998, which was terrible, and leaving the place like a building site, similar to what you saw today.
Yeah.
Okay, they can do that, all of that mess,
and they won't allow me to dig a little piece of flat grass that's 2 meters by 2 meters.
Right.
Now that's how ridiculous it is.
Right. Okay.
All right then, Wadid. Well, on that note, thank you very much for making me feel welcome here in Ireland.
You're very welcome.
And good luck with all of your projects and films.
Thank you very much for coming.
And also the 5th of November, good luck with that venture as well.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Every month, thousands of worshippers in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church gather in their holiest city, Aksum, for the Mihilila Thanksgiving celebration. The focal point, hidden beneath a red velvet canopy and never revealed, is a revered object called a tabot, a replica of the Ark of the Covenant. The Bible's Old Testament says God commanded the Ark to be built to contain the tablets recording his Ten Commandments. But the Ark disappeared from Jerusalem after the destruction of King Solomon's temple. Ethiopians say it was brought to their country by Menelik, the son of Queen Sheba and King Solomon. The Ark's existence and location has intrigued scholars, archaeologists, and Hollywood. But the faithful gathered here are convinced that the Ark of the Covenant rests in Aksum. Christianity arrived in Ethiopia around 1700 years ago, and almost half the population belongs to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. The tabot is carried back to the chapel of St. Mary Zion. The church believes the object's importance cannot be exaggerated.
It is still the most holiest and respected object as it is. It is the most precious object in history. It's something that has been used by God for the communication of the people, between his people and himself. The manifestation of God always occurred around the Ark.
This man is the guardian of the Ark. He never leaves the chapel grounds, and only he may see the mysterious relic hidden behind the curtain of the Holy of Holies. Before he dies, the guardian will choose his successor from the monks of St. Mary Zion. The guardian isn't allowed to speak publicly, and his representative adds to the mystery.
I'm laughing because if I say I've seen the Holy Ark of the Covenant, this means I've opened it. This is not a simple thing. To see the Ark, nobody has seen it, apart from the Guardian.
The Aksumite story of the Ark is contained in a historic book. Menelik takes the Ark from the temple. Holding the chest, he crosses the Red Sea, but a wall of water stops King Solomon's troops. Queen Sheba awaits the Ark's arrival in Aksum. Menelik and the Ark enter the city in triumph. When Aksum was later destroyed by enemies, the Ark's guardians are said to have taken it to an island on Lake Tana. They only returned it to the rebuilt city several hundred years later. Aksum is the cradle of Ethiopian civilization, with obelisks predating the Christian period, but only this one remaining intact. A bigger one, weighing more than 100 tons, was taken away by Italian leader Mussolini's colonial troops in 1937, and Ethiopia still wants it back. Aksum was formerly a trading center between Africa and Asia. Its markets displayed gold, ivory, incense, and spices. Now its long Christian heritage attracts worshippers from all over the country and a few from abroad. The devotion of ordinary Ethiopians to their religion and to the Ark is evident.
As a Christian, I'm very happy the Ark of the Covenant is in Aksum. And I'm very proud that I'm part of the population and a Christian.
This is Tana Kirkus Island, which in the Aksumite version of the story is where the ark was hidden before being returned to the city. But some Ethiopians believe a different account. They say that Menelik and High Priest Azariah brought the ark directly here from Jerusalem. The island's only inhabitants are these few monks whose lives are dedicated to the ark.
According to the story I have from my grandparents and their grandparents, Menelik and Azariah brought the Ark of the Covenant from Jerusalem to here in 4518 BC. There were no buildings, and they were keeping it in an empty area. And there, they offered sacrifices for the Ark of the Covenant.
The island's church may look rudimentary, but it is said to contain the sacred object which no one may see without permission from the Orthodox Church's patriarch. The monks say the original church was built by the first patriarch when he came to bless the holy chest. Is the Ark of the Covenant hidden in this Holy of Holies? Neither the head priest nor the monks will answer the question. The building contains ancient texts depicting biblical events, including Moses stretching out to receive the tablets. The texts also contain stories of Christian saints, all of whom have their place in Ethiopian Orthodox Church tradition. The history of the church itself goes back many years and embraces several ancient beliefs, with the Old Testament of particular importance.
We should consider Ethiopian Christianity as a kind of Judaic Christianity. And the patriarch, the present patriarch, is on record once as saying that the Ethiopian church is 3,000 years old, 1,000 Jewish and 2,000 Christian. And I think one can say that this is a culture in which the Old Testament is of very great importance, more so than in the Western Christianity.
This is Aksum's annual Timkat Baptism Festival. The tablet of the Ark leaves the chapel. It's securely guarded. Music is integral to the ceremony. In the late afternoon, the procession winds slowly towards the place where the tablet will rest overnight. Although the Timkat festival is linked to Jesus' baptism in the River Jordan, Old Testament traditions concerning the Ark remain central to the ritual. The tablet is moved carefully and with great rejoicing. The tablet will rest here overnight. Its presence means the tent has become a church. As the sun sets over Aksum, the faithful inside the tent church turn again to prayer and devotion. The Timkat festival is celebrated by Ethiopian Orthodox Christians all over the country, but it's particularly important in this holiest of cities. Aksum becomes an even more important place of pilgrimage during the celebrations. The next morning, a crowd gathers to prepare for the blessing of the water, which will become sacred in the presence of the tablet. Worshippers wait around the edge of what is referred to as Queen Sheba's bath. Although modern, to believers it resonates with history and their religious heritage. Questioning the whereabouts of the Ark of the Covenant is irrelevant to these worshippers. As the three candles symbolizing the Holy Trinity drift away, they know that the Ark rests in Aksum.
Yes.